Good morning, everybody. It is Monday, January 25th, and this is our morning live, drive live, first of the new week, last week of January. We finished, almost finished a full month of the year. So, ready to move on and get going. So, today, I want to talk about non-covered services. Many states, the vast majority, have a non-covered services law. We will have, later on today, a state-by-state listing of all of those with non-covered services laws and what they mean for each different state. But what I'm going to talk about right now is in the vast majority of them. Remember, there are states like Ohio and New York who currently do not have a non-covered services law. In those states without a law, the insurance company makes the rules. So you go by the EOB. So if you're in Ohio or you're in New York or any one of the other states that doesn't have a non-covered services law, you go by the EOB. If the EOB says charge your full price, you charge your full price. If the EOB says charge your allowed price, you charge your allowed price. Because in those states without a rule, the insurance company makes the rules. So, in the states that have a non-covered services law, there is a big difference between non-covered and non-payable. So, let's talk about that a little bit. A lot of people think, well, we did fluoride in an adult, it's not a covered service because there's no adult fluoride coverage. Well, there is no adult fluoride code anymore. So they got rid of the fluoride codes that were dictated by age, and they are strictly fluoride varnish and fluoride all other types. So 1206, 1208, there is no longer a distinction between adult fluoride, child fluoride, so on and so forth. So if you're in one of the vast majority of states with a non-covered services law that's written this way, then if 1206 or 1208, if fluoride is a covered benefit but is subject to an age limitation, the patient pays the allowed fee. In those states that have a non-covered services law written the way the vast majority of them are, there's very few that aren't written this way, but we will put that on the form on our resources page of our website this afternoon. However, if it is not payable due to annual maximum, frequency limitation, age limitation, a missing tooth clause, least expensive alternative clause, any other contract limitation, that doesn't mean it's not covered. That means it's not payable. And if it's not payable, the patient still gets the insurance allowed fee. So, fluoride on an adult, fluoride is a covered benefit, but only up to age 18 or only up to age 16. That patient will pay, the adult will pay the allowed insurance fee for fluoride. Same thing with a crown. Let's say you do a crown on a patient. The patient had one done 4 years ago at another office. There's a 5-year frequency limitation for restorations for another crown on that tooth. The patient's within that. The crown is not payable because of a frequency limitation. If it's not payable due to a contract clause frequency limitation, the patient pays. They will pay for it out of pocket because insurance will not pay anything. But the patient will pay the insurance allowed fee, the negotiated rate. That's what they're going to pay if they're getting that crown done 4 years later when they have a 5-year frequency limitation on their plan. So, you know, that's a big thing. People need to understand the difference between non-covered and not payable. Same thing, annual maximum. This is always a big one. Well, it's not covered because they've met their annual max. It is still a covered benefit. It's just not payable. It's not payable because the patient has met their annual maximum. So if it's not payable, but it is a covered service, the patient pays the insurance allowed, the negotiated rate, the fee schedule allowance from the insurance company. Maxed out, missing tooth clause, frequency limitation, age limitation, any contract limitation, any one of those clauses that we talked about before, many, many weeks ago, the beginning of the year, in the vast majority of states, the patient pays the allowed fee. So, you know, the best way to think about this, I go with what's called the never ever rule. The never ever rule says if it's something that would never ever be covered. So cosmetic dentistry is never covered. Never ever covered. You know, you may find a plan or two, had a patient that was a Supreme Court justice. Their plan paid 100% of everything. He could have come in every 3 months and gotten brand new veneers on every one of his teeth and it would have been paid at 100%. But short of one of those plans, if it's never, ever covered, the insurance company considers it non-covered, which means the patient pays your full office fee. So never, ever. So like a crown on a preventative only plan, or I can't even say whitening because there are some plans that do cover whitening. Hopefully everybody knows there's a CDT code for whitening per arch. Submit it. You have to submit it if you're in network. You have to send the claim saying that you did in-office whitening per arch. You have to have a fee for that. Some plans, I've seen very few. Honestly, in 20 years, maybe 5 plans have actually paid for it or had an allowance for it. So, you know, you have to know those things, but never, ever covered. A crown on a preventative-only plan. A root canal on a basic restorative-only plan. Something like that. If it's never, ever covered, no matter what, then you would charge your full fee because it's non-covered. Again, it does vary per state. So in some states, you're going to have no law about this. Ohio, New York, there's a couple others that have no law right now. We're going to have on our website, practicemechanic.com, click on resources in the upper right-hand side. Later on this afternoon, we're going to have the complete state-by-state listing of what's covered, what states have a covered and non-covered services law. So that'll be posted this afternoon. Everybody have a great day. I am here, and I will see you tomorrow. Good morning, everybody. Today's a little bit of a weird day because we, in my area, are expecting about a quarter of an inch of ice to coat everything today. So instead of our normal drive live, today we're gonna do bitching from the kitchen because that's where I'm at, getting ready to work from home and start my day today. So our normal drive live will be replaced today with bitching from the kitchen. And what I wanna talk about today is going out of network. There's been a lot of people, a lot of posts all across Facebook talking about going out of network, talking about dropping network participation with insurance companies, and, you know, figured that's something we should talk about briefly today. And today seemed like a good day because, again, because of
a ridiculous quarter of an inch of ice covering everything in my area. We are working from home. So, network participation status. I do believe, depending on your demographic, depending on the area that you're in, it can work. It works in a lot of offices. There's a ton of fee-for-service offices. It's under 5%, but it can work. A big part of it has to do with the demographic in your area, has to do with the type of patient you have. If you're in an area with a higher average household income, you're gonna have an easier time than if you're in an area with 3,500 people, you know, population of 3,500, average household income is $42,000 a year, and two people in the house are working to make that. There's a big difference between that and being in the 90210 zip code where, you know, network participation status may not be as important. I have, however, seen multi-millionaires switch dentists because the dentist they go to and they like and love and have gone to for 15 years dropped network participation. So, you know, there is no all-in-one. However, let's talk about the process to go out of network and to start dropping plans. For me, this is completely a numbers game. It's 100% numbers. That's what a business is. So, how do we look at that? First of all, you look at who you are in network with. This is a big question. I answer hundreds of emails every week saying, you know, oh, we want to sign up, we want to do this, we want to get started with you for our remote billing. But, you know, one of the questions on your questionnaire is, who are you in network with? I'm in network with everybody. People don't even know who they're in network with. So step one is figure out who you are in network with. That's step one. Step two is identify the fee schedules. So first you have to know who you're in network with. Second, you have to know what your fee schedule with each one is. Because I can tell you, if you're in network with 10 companies, it may not be the best choice to drop your lowest paying fee schedule, the lowest reimbursing company, if that company represents 45 or 50% of your patient base. So if you're in network with Delta, MetLife, Aetna, United, Concordia, and Delta is your lowest paying fee schedule, but they represent 40% of your patient base, that's probably not the place to start. So first we have to identify who we're in network with, then we have to look at the fee schedules. We have to look at what the level, the reimbursement level is for each fee schedule, and figure that out. So I do that with a numbers game that I play that, you know, kind of works like this. I figure out how many insurance companies I'm in network with. Now, if I'm in network through an umbrella with 10, I count that as one because they're reimbursing based on the umbrella's fee schedule. So I will say I'm in network with Carrington. Now, under Carrington, you may have, you know, Aetna and this one and that one and the other one, but I count it as one, I count it as Carrington. Number two, I look at their fee schedule and I take their fee schedule and I figure out what percentage of my office fees they are reimbursing. So let's say I'm in network with 10 insurance companies. Number one, what percentage of my UCR, of my office fee, are they reimbursing? And then I rank them from 1 to 10. So the highest reimbursing, the one that's reimbursing 82% of my UCR, is gonna be number one. The one that's reimbursing 52% of my UCR is gonna be number 10. And they each get a number value, 1 through 10, based on percent of UCR reimbursed. Then I look at the number of patients that I have in my office that are under that plan or through that insurance company or are in network with me through that company, through that fee schedule. And I assign those a ranking of 1 through 10 based on the number of patients. So, you know, somebody who is representative, Delta represents 42% of my patient base, they're going to be number one. If United Concordia represents 4% of my patient base, and that's my lowest one, they're going to be number 10. Then I add those two numbers together. So, you know, if United Concordia is my lowest reimbursing fee schedule, they're going to be assigned that number 10 for fee schedule. If they are also my lowest percentage of participation, my lowest number of patients, they're going to be 10 for that one. So 10 plus 10 is 20, and that's how I start. I start by dropping my 20. Then I drop, if I have one, then I drop my 19, then I drop my 18. But this is over time. This is a process, because, you know, doing it that way, you're getting rid of your lowest paying and your lowest participating all at the same time. And I'm watching this to get a percentage, to look at the number of patients that I retain when I drop them. And that's a super important number to know as we get into the insurance companies that have a larger percentage of our patient base, when we get into the MetLifes and the Deltas and the Aetnas that could represent 20, 30, 40, 50% of my patient base. Those numbers become important, because then it truly becomes all about patient retention. So I look at my retention numbers from the little ones, from the low reimbursing, from the low participation. Look at the retention numbers. So I know I started 2021 with 116 in-network patients for United Concordia. Now I drop them. Now I want to look 6 months from now, how many do I still have? How many have come for their recall, have rescheduled, are coming back again, will be here for their next visit, have made it through that year, and I've retained. Then I have my retention percentage, and that tells me two things. Number one, if I drop all the insurance companies all at once, that tells me how many patients I'm gonna have. So if I have a 50% retention rate, and out of 1,000 insured patients, I know I'm gonna drop every one of those insurance plans, that means those 1,000 patients, I'm gonna have 500 at the end of the year. You know, we look at averages, we look at numbers. So that means either I need to make up the lost revenue on those 500 patients, which if you have insurance companies that are denying services, that are not allowing you to charge for services, you know, crown buildups and whatnot, when you drop them, you're going to immediately make up that increased revenue. Number two, you're going to make up increased revenue because you're seeing patients at your UCR. So, you know, from a profit margin standpoint, we'll talk about profit margins later in the week, but from a profit margin standpoint, one, the profit on one fee-for-service crown can actually be greater than the profit for three PPO crowns. Because remember, we're looking at profit margins, we're looking at percentages, we're not looking at, you know, number of services done, we're looking at a profit percentage. So, you know, that's the way to do it. Know your numbers. So, here we go. First, identify who you are in network with. Second, identify all of the fee schedules. I am amazed at how many offices don't know what fee schedule each insurance company is reimbursing from. And that's just, you have to know that. If you're in network, you have to know that. There's no way to treatment plan, there's no way to estimate, there's no way to do any of that without knowing the fee schedule that each company's in network with. So know that, one and two. Assign each in-network insurance company a value based on, you know, those two things, number of patients that have that plan, number one, and number two, the percentage of UCR they reimburse. I'm working on a worksheet. Today's a good day for me to get this done in Excel that will, you know, hopefully get uploaded to the group files today, and we'll make these calculations super easy. When it's up there, I'll let everybody know. I'll comment on this post, and I'll also post it naturally in the group files, so that'll generate a post in the group. But, you know, that's step one. Step two is identify, after you've started dropping, your lowest ranked or highest number insurance company, identify what your retention rates are going to be. Bear in mind, they may be a little different. You know, you get in a state, you're in an area where Delta will not reimburse or allow assignment of benefits to the office. If you're out of network, that may change your retention rate, but that's okay. We want to get an average. That's what it's all about. So remember, profit margins are king. You know, one fee-for-service crown can actually generate more profit than three PPO crowns. We're going to look at that again later in the week. We're going to talk about profit margins. Hopefully I can get back on the road tomorrow. The ice clears up. But everybody have a great day. I'm going to work on that Excel spreadsheet today. I'm going to get that uploaded to the group file so you can start ranking your insurance companies, looking at your network participation status, and identifying the best place to start dropping. Now, everybody have a great day. I'm going to try and avoid the ice, and I will see you guys tomorrow. Take you down, deep down to the front line. Deep down. You woke up this morning, got yourself gone. Your mama always said you'd be the chosen one. She said you're one in a million. You got to burn the shine. You were born under a bad sign with a blue moon in your eyes. Good morning, everybody. It is Wednesday, January 27th, and we are back on the road for our drive lives. So, today I want to talk about perio, the periodontal process, and appropriate coding. So, number one, the most used improperly code that there is, the full mouth debridement, D4355. Yesterday, as a lot of you know, I was working from home. We had icy road conditions yesterday and working from home. So I got to answer a lot more questions than I normally do. See a lot more of my Facebook messages than I normally do because I wasn't at the office with everybody harassing me. Yesterday alone, I got 6 Facebook messages talking about the gross debridement code, the full mouth debridement code. Here's one of them. Patient hasn't been in a year, so they skipped one recall. Before that, they were good. We're coming every 6 months. Everything was good. The hygienist did spot probing and found a couple fours. So she did a gross debridement along with a perio exam.
So here's where that went wrong. 4355, full mouth debridement, is only to be used when there is so much calculus buildup, you cannot complete a comprehensive exam. You cannot do periocharting. So, you know, this person that messaged me didn't understand why insurance wasn't paying for the gross debridement when she sent the perio chart from the day of the gross debridement as backup. And I said, that is your problem. If you were able to do the perio charting, the patient didn't need a gross debridement. So, you know, that's a big thing. It is honestly probably easily in the top five most misused codes is full mouth debridement. The only time it is appropriate is if there is so much calculus buildup, you cannot complete a perio chart. If you have a perio chart dated the same day of your gross debridement, you miscoded. So let's go back to that original example. What should that have been coded as? If the patient skipped one prophy and now they had a couple fours and bleeding on every tooth, what they should have had is a 4-3-4-6, scaling in the presence of gingivitis. That's what the patient should have received. They obviously have gingivitis. The gingivitis started. The gingivitis is active. It's not periodontal disease yet because we don't have bone loss. We've covered that before. There's no bone loss. There's no periodontal disease. There's no periodontal disease. There's no need for scaling and root planing. So we got that D4346 code a couple years ago to be in the middle. What used to be called a bloody prophy. That's what D4346 is. That's its intended use. So, you know, please, 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 if a patient comes in and you are able to do a perio chart, you are able to complete a comprehensive evaluation, get the perio charting done, get the exam done. The patient does not need a gross debridement. So, patient comes in, they don't need a gross debridement. Now the determination is, do they have periodontal disease? Are they going to be a scaling and root planing? Are they going to be a 4-3-4-6, scaling in the presence of gingivitis? Or are they just going to be a regular prophy patient? Right now, the vast majority of dental offices are coding every patient, are doing prophys on every patient. Unfortunately, according to a number of sources, including the American Periodontic Association, the American Dental Association, more than 50% of adult patients have some form of periodontal disease or gingivitis. So, are we coding correctly? Are the vast majority of the population who have periodontal disease or gingivitis not going to the dentist? I don't know, but we need to be coding it correctly. And doing a 4355 along with a comp exam is not only impossible, because it says right in the code to enable comprehensive evaluation. So if you can do a comprehensive evaluation, the 4355 is an inappropriate code, because it's only done when you can't do a comprehensive evaluation. So, you know, that's something to look out for. The other thing when it comes to that D4355, yes, you can bill it along with a limited exam, or bill it with a D0160. You know, a lot of offices don't use that DO160 code, and I don't know why. It's there. It's covered. Insurances pay for it. So why offices aren't using it, I don't know. I wish I did. I wish I knew why more offices weren't using it. But D0160 is a problem-focused limited exam, but a comprehensive problem-focused exam. You can bill that out if the patient comes in for a consult for implants. You're focusing on one problem. You're doing a comprehensive exam focused on just that one problem. So, yes, you can bill a DO-140 along with the full mouth debridement. Realize, however, when you do that, it's going to use one of their exam frequencies. So that patient gets two exams per year. They're going to use one of those two for the DO-140 that you did along with the gross debridement. That's fine, because if that's what you're doing, that's what you do. You know, bill what you do and do what you bill. That's the rule. So, you know, you have to pay attention to that. Yes, you can bill it with a DO-140. No, you cannot bill it with a DO-120, a DO-150, because you're not able to do the full exam. Problem focus, DO-140, that's fine. You're focused on the problem. The problem is the calculus buildup. So you're focused on that. So bill the DO-140 with the gross debridement if you like. Depending on the time of year, depending on what I know is going to come up with the patient. I mean, if they're going to be in 3 or 4 more times this year and I'm going to be doing exams, I might not bill the DO-140. We'll bill the gross debridement and bring them back for the comp, because we're probably not even really doing one. The doctor's coming in, they're taking a quick look and saying, yes, I don't want to use one of the exam frequencies for that. But, please, please, please remember, 4355, the gross debridement, is only used when there is so much calculus you cannot do a comprehensive evaluation. You can't do a comp exam. So, super important to remember, pay attention to that, educate your hygienists on what that means, because they're hopping in, they're saying, oh, let's do a full mouth debridement after doing full perio charting. Full mouth debridement is not the middle ground between a prophy and a scaling. It's not the middle ground. So keep that in mind. Let me know if you have any questions. I am at my first stop for the morning. I will see you guys tomorrow. Have a great day. Good morning, everybody. It is Thursday, January 28th, and this is our morning drive live. So, yesterday, I posted in the file section of the group a state-by-state non-covered services law breakdown. So, I just want to talk about that a little bit and, fill everybody in on what exactly that means, because it got a lot of questions. So, non-covered services laws have been passed by a number of states, the vast majority of them, that say if a service is not covered by an insurance plan, the insurance plan cannot dictate what fee is charged. So at that point, you don't have to charge the insurance allowed fee, the fee schedule fee. You charge your office's UCR, your normal full office fee, for a non-covered service. However, there are a few states, two to be exact, that are a little different in what they consider non-covered services. Kentucky and Oregon say if the insurance company is not paying for the service, they cannot dictate the fee. That's different than the rest of the states who have passed this law. Now, quick breakdown on the form. We've highlighted each state a color. There is red, there is yellow, and there is green. The red states do not have a non-covered services law, which means the insurance company dictates the fee. There's no law preventing that. So your contract, if you are in network, your contract in those states dictates that even if a service is non-covered, you will charge the allowed insurance fee, not your full office fee. Those are the red states. The yellow states, which is the vast majority of them, follow what's called the never ever rule. So if something is never ever covered, like a crown on a preventative only plan, never ever covered, then you can charge your full office fee. However, if something is covered but not payable due to a contract limitation, so something like a least expensive alternative clause, or a waiting period, or the patient's annual maximum, a missing tooth clause, a frequency limitation, then you charge, and these are the states in yellow on the spreadsheet, on the listing of the states, you charge the insurance fee schedule allowed fee. So just because it's not payable doesn't mean it's not covered. So what this means is if you have a patient who gets a new plan, it's January for a couple more days, they got a new plan, new insurance policy, everything is great, they bought it themselves, they're super happy, that plan is gonna have a waiting period. Most waiting periods are 6 to 12 months for any major work. So the patient gets a new plan, they have a 12-month waiting period for a crown, but they need a crown. In the states that are yellow on the spreadsheet, you charge the insurance fee schedule price, not your full office fee. Even though insurance is not paying anything towards it, it would be a covered benefit if it were not for the waiting period. The patient pays the insurance allowed fee. That's a contract limitation, the waiting period. Let's say a patient had a crown done at another office 4 years ago and they need it redone. There's recurrent decay. They need a new crown. The plan has a 5-year frequency limitation. In those states that are yellow, you are going to charge the patient the insurance allowed fee schedule price, not your full office fee. Because again, it is a covered benefit, but it's not payable because of the frequency limitation. So that's the difference with those. And then again, to go back to the green states, which is Kentucky and Oregon, if the insurance company is not paying, they can't dictate that. So in those two states, let's say, you know, you're in Kentucky and that patient has a 5-year frequency limitation, you're doing the crown that was just done 4 years ago. If the insurance company doesn't pay anything towards it, they can't dictate treatment or they can't dictate the fee. So in that circumstance, you're charging the patient your full office fee. It is a covered service, but it's not covered. It's not being paid by the insurance company. So you can charge your full office fee for that crown. Even though the patient has insurance, even though there's a allowance on the insurance company's fee schedule for that service, you're charging your full office fee because insurance is not making payment towards that service. It is only two states, Kentucky and Oregon, that follow that rule. The vast majority of them are the never ever rule. So real quick, where this comes into play a lot is I see people say, Well, but we did fluoride on an adult, and we charged our $35 office fee, even though insurance only allows $20. Adult fluoride is not a covered service. That's correct, but here's the kickers. A, there is no code anymore for adult fluoride. The fluoride codes got changed. 1206, 1208, fluoride varnish, fluoride everything else. Whether it's gel, whether it's the rinse, whether it's the foam, that is all 1208. So there is no more age separation in the fluoride codes. So if fluoride is a covered benefit, you're in one of the yellow or red states. Fluoride is a covered benefit, but only up to age 16. That is not payable due to an age limitation, which means an adult, a 50-year-old getting fluoride, is going to pay the allowed fee, not the office's full fee for that fluoride. Because remember, there is no more adult fluoride. There's only varnish and everything else. They're your two choices. So it's not payable due to an age limitation. The patient pays the insurance allowed fee if you're in one of the yellow or red states. And again, the red states don't have a law, which doesn't mean you can do what you want. That means the insurance companies can do what they want. So they make the rules. So you have to follow the EOB. So I am here, I'm pulling in. I'm sure there's gonna be a ton of questions about this. Now there was already, starting at 4 a.m., I started getting Facebook messages from that post. So that's why I wanted to do a quick live on it. Everybody have a great day. I will see you tomorrow and I'll be answering your questions throughout the day. Have a great day. Good morning, everybody. It is Friday, January 29th. And this is our drive live. So today we're gonna talk about, so been a lot of discussion and you know a lot of people in the group know the answer to this, but we also have to remember we have a lot of new people coming from other positions within the office who may not know this. So there is a big difference between twice a year or once every 6 months. This can apply to prophys, this can apply to perio maintenance, this can apply to exams. And the twice a year versus once every 6 months policies that a lot of insurance plans have. So twice a year can mean one of two things. It can either mean twice in a calendar year or twice in a plan year. Not every insurance plan runs January through December. Some start in April or May. They can start whenever the company signed up for that plan if they elect to do a rolling year. So if you work for a company and their dental plan renews in May, your plan for calendar year benefits for annual maximums is going to run May through April instead of January through December resetting on January 1st like normal. So, you know, when we look at twice in a year, it can either be two times in a calendar year or two times in a plan year if the plan doesn't run with the calendar. So that means a patient could come in, they could have an exam on January 1st, an exam on January 2nd, and then get nothing again for the rest of the year. That is twice in a calendar year, or twice in a plan year if you're doing it by plan year. So, you know, there is no waiting period in between. So, I mean, literally a patient could come in, have a prophy one day, have a prophy the next. Both will get paid because the plan pays two times per year. Those two times could be 2 days in a row. And the plan will pay, everything will be fine, but then the patient's gonna come back 6 months later, for their recall, and it's not going to be paid. Every 6 months means just that. It's pretty much the opposite of that. It means that the plan will pay for an exam or a prophy or a perio maintenance or whatever it may be every 6 months. So we say 6 months plus a day. So if a patient comes in on January 15th for a prophy and exam, and their plan allows it every 6 months, they would be eligible on July 15th plus a day. So we always do 6 months plus 1 day. Some plans, very few, will pay on the 6 month anniversary. So you could do January 15th, July 15th. But most of the time, that's going to be considered within the 6 months. So we always do 6 months plus a day. So that is the difference between 2 times per year and every 6 months. This applies to a lot of things. So, you know, remember, exams, prophys, perio maintenance, a lot of this, these frequency limitations apply. Now, one of the topics that came up yesterday in the group was triggering events. So basically, a lot of plans have gone to, over the past 2 years or so, a lot of plans have gone to triggering events, whether insurance pays for them or not. So if you have a patient who's on an every 3 month prophy, that patient comes in, let's say January 15th, insurance will pay. They're an every 6 month plan. Insurance will pay for it. Now they come back April 15th. It's within 6 months, insurance will not pay. If you are in network, you still submit the claim because you did it and your contract requires you to. Now the patient comes back for their July 15th prophy. You submit it expecting insurance to pay, but insurance is going to pay. This is every 6 months, and the patient just had one 3 months ago. So even though insurance didn't pay for it, it's still a triggering event, and it still triggers the every 6 month frequency. So at that point, you now have a situation where insurance is never going to pay for a prophy again, because you're always hitting a triggering event and resetting that frequency trigger. So patient comes in January 15th, prophy paid. Patient comes in April 15th, prophy not paid, triggering event. Within 6 months. Patient comes in July 15th, not paid, because they had one within 6 months in April. Patient comes in July, so it would be, October? Not paid because they had one in July. So even if it's not paid for, it's still a triggering event that restarts the frequency. A lot of plans also are now beginning to consider bite wings inclusive with an FMX. So if a patient has bite wing coverage once every 12 months and the doctor determines that it has to be taken every 12 months because the patient's risk factors needed for proper care for the patient, but the patient had an FMX the last time they were in, insurance will not pay for the bite wings because bite wings are included in an FMX and they just had one 6 months ago, which means now you can't take bite wings for 12 months after the FMX. But if you took them today after they had an FMX 6 months ago, you took them today, you submit them, insurance denies because they're inclusive with the FMX and 12-month frequency, you've just restarted that 12-month timer to today. So now you can't take them the next time they're in. You have to wait 12 months plus a day. So hopefully that makes sense to everybody. If you have questions about that, you know, if you're new in the dental office, if you need clarification, ask away. I am here. It is Friday. Everybody have a wonderful weekend. I am here at the office. Today's a super busy day. So I am here. Everybody have a great day. Have a wonderful weekend, and I will see you on Monday.